on now and talk about the most important thing that happened this last few days has been Pharrell Williams' debut at Louis Vuitton for Spring 2024 men's. I've said my piece already before, how I thought that the Pharrell appointment was the wrong appointment. I was really looking forward to seeing somebody like a Martine Rose or a Grace Bonner be given that platform, or somebody else within that ilk. I just mostly thought about it in the terms of, okay, if it's going to be somebody black, which is something that the people or the brass at Louis Vuitton were really kind of insistent on and wanting to make sure that was an actual thing, and if it was super important in terms of, you know, continuing on that conversation and that kind of journey that Virgil was on, which I've only recently learned, RIP to Virgil, that he was only 3 years into his flipping appointment at fucking Louis Vuitton before he unfortunately passed away. So all that work he did beforehand to kind of get to that position and get that job, the work that he did while he was at Louis Vuitton, it felt like he put out, I don't know, 12 collections in 3 years. It really is crazy to think he was only at Louis Vuitton for 3 years. Absolutely insane. But in general, the noises coming out from Louis V were that they were always going to kind of favor somebody black to take that position. That was the most important thing. But then when we saw people like Kid Super doing a one-off collection with Louis Vuitton, myself and probably a few others were really disheartened, because Kid Super fucking sucks, and the collection he put out was a poor imitation of what Virgil Abloh did before, and it kind of led a bad taste in most of our mouths. But then a lot of us kind of moved on and kind of accepted, hey, LVMH is LVMH, they're going to do what they're going to do, whatever's best for their company, they're going to do it. The kind of the streetwear story of Virgil at Louis V kind of essentially quote unquote died with his passing, so let's just let the next person who takes the reins do what they want to do with it. But then out of the blue, Kid Super doesn't get the role at Louis Vuitton, even though he gets a chance to do it for one time, which is really strange. Maybe it's because he won the LVMH prize one time, so it kind of gave him some special privileges to get that job for that one season. You know, even though I still think him winning the LVMH prize that year was one of the greatest charities of all time, up there with fucking, what's his face, up there with Macklemore, you know, winning album of the year over fucking Kendrick Lamar, really heinous. And if anything, I've always said this before, that I think, you know, Kid Super winning the LVMH prize should be encouragement for everybody out there to go and chase their dreams. Doesn't matter what your dream is, and to never have imposter syndrome, because if somebody like that, who is that average and that mediocre, could get to that sort of level, then it obviously shows you that all that's required is just to have a good attitude and work ethic. Because the one thing you hear a lot about Kid Super is that he's super nice, he's a great guy, people have heard of great things to say about him. So clearly having a good attitude, working really hard, is going to get you a long way in life. Anyway, long story less long, Pharrell definitely finally got the job at Louis Vuitton. I was very surprised. I didn't think he'd do well there, because from what I remember, growing up, being around, you know, growing up during Pharrell's ascent into culture, I was somebody that was very kind of, you know, ingratiated in the kind of streetwear scene here in London and far beyond, and I kind of saw his kind of, you know, ascent from when he was doing music and then obviously permeating into the streetwear world with the work he was doing with Nigo, with Billionaire Boys Club, with Bape, with Ice Cream, then with Human Made and all this other stuff he's doing in between. He's always been somebody that I felt like was the great person to kind of collaborate with small collections and collaborations and little trinkets and glasses and sunglasses, jewelry, watches and stuff, all those sort of things I felt like for Pharrell would always kind of, you know, excel at. But when it comes to creating a full collection, the last time he did anything great in terms of full body of quote unquote work in terms of clothing was the time that he was doing Billionaire Boys Club. But if you remember Billionaire Boys Club origin, most of that great stuff during BBC era was stuff that was made with the collaboration and the help of Nigo, and of course the graphic design flipping mastery of Skate Thing, who's responsible for some of the best graphics to come out of Bape. So once that kind of ended the way it ended, and Pharrell kind of had to rely on his own team and himself, the work kind of dipped. And to this point, I feel like, you know, BB's Billionaire Boys Club is like a shadow of the brand it was beforehand, and hardly anybody wears it really that's serious. So I was a bit dubious that Pharrell could come in and create a 60 plus look collection that would resonate with people. Well, guess what? I have to eat some humble bloody pie, because this spring 2024 collection that I watched live on stream the other day, and I'm going to go over again and check over the pictures, was absolutely mind-blowingly good. I thought the first half of the show was a little bit not for me, a little bit lackluster. It kind of felt a little bit like another Kim Jones show for Dior, where there was loads of creams and greens and whatever. It kind of felt like another kind of urban safari type of thing that Kim Jones is kind of obsessed with, and I wasn't too enamored with it. But once it started getting into the middle and the end section of the show, suddenly the colors started to brighten, the silhouette started to get more interesting, the casting started to get more interesting, the bags were fucking great. Suddenly I was like, oh my god, Pharrell definitely smashed this one out of the park. The show, so let's go through the clothes straight away and let's go to the things that I really, really adored. Like I said, I think the first half of the show was definitely not for me in terms of the aesthetic, in terms of the color palette, in terms of some of the bits and pieces on it. But one thing I could kind of see that really kind of resonated for me was something that I spotted in one of the articles where they said, Pharrell said something along the lines of using the word tweaks. And I thought that was a great approach to take with being a non-traditionally trained designer. Not even in the sake of, like, you know, Virgil also wasn't trained, but he came from having a brand himself that he kind of built from the ground up in Off-White and doing loads of other different collaborations. Whereas Pharrell's always been kind of like I'd say like the kind of pinnacle of an influencer, in that he's got a taste, he's got a point of view, but he also operates it from a point of view of being like a very, very informed consumer. So the best way to kind of approach that, I would think, would be to be, if you be a creative director of a luxury fashion house, would actually be to just improve on classic silhouettes and shapes, as opposed to coming in and trying to be Alexander McQueen, because you don't have the chops. So why not just take your consumer brain and be like, oh, okay, if I wanted to create, if I got the keys to a Louis Vuitton factory and I wanted to create the best, you know, fitting suit, what would it look like? What would it feel like? What would the finish? What would the shape? What, you know what I mean? That's how you would approach it. And I like that he did, because if you look throughout the entire collection, there's loads of shapes and silhouettes we all know, from blazer jackets to trench coats to shorts to button-up shirts to bomber jackets, suit, ties, like every shape that we kind of know, without really anything crazy that's going to go, you know, too far out there. And again, the addition of the quality of the hats, the little sprinkling of little randomness here and there with these kind of Mary Jane shoes, which I think are going to be interestingly challenging for people to wear. I do like the ability of kind of mixing and kind of, you know, this you know, this masculine, I guess, one side of the top, and then having this femininity at the bottom with these kind of frilly pop socks and these massive chunky Mary Jane shoes. Like I said, I'm going to be interested to see who actually decides to wear these and give these a chance, because I think, you know, the regular gays are going to definitely jump onto this and make this work. But I would like to see a somewhat hetero dude pull this off and make this look good. I think Tyler, the Creator, would actually look good in this outfit, look number 14. He'd actually swag it out, but I'm interested to see how that kind of looks. The addition of these boots, I think there's been a really big trend of people making these. They kind of feel like fireman boots, like I have, that Kanye was wearing. They also kind of remind me a little bit of Red Wing engineered boots, where they kind of, you know, they come just below the knee. They're usually very, very big and thick soled, very durable, basically get, you know, the more you batter them, the better they look type of a feel. And I feel like many brands, this Paris Fashion Week, and obviously Milan Fashion Week before that, have done their version of these type of boots. I just think it's a thing that's in for that particular season. And of course, wearing shorts, they look great. This look number 15 is also one of my favorites. A great kind of, it feels like a pajama suit, with this great little hat that looks like it could be a do-rag with the straps underneath it. And the thing that I think is going to be really popular are these shoes. I think Rocky was wearing them. They're these slippers that look like they got these little bear paws at the bottom of them, but essentially they're these fluffy Louis Vuitton slipper things that I feel it would be incredibly popular with people once they eventually get inside the stores. There's loads of things I can see there, I can say that for. This look number 17, another of my favorites. This kind of metallic-y type of print on the jacket with, I'm assuming, LV kind of embossed over it. The shape of the bomber is superb. Maybe the model sells it the most, but the shape falls incredibly well, because again, Pharrell's been wearing these items, these streetwear staples like hoodies, like bomber jackets, like varsity jackets, like shorts, like t-shirts for many, many years. So he knows what a great fitting bomber should look like on a body, especially with assistance of somebody like Anigo, who's also assisting him. From what we've seen so far, the Cactus Plant Flower Market girl is helping, and also Matthew Henson, who used to style, I'm not sure if he still does, ASAP Rocky, is also involved in the styling of the collection, which is definitely on point. Everything here looks completely wearable, and I'll be into. There's a pair of shoes here that look really interesting on this look number 16. They remind me of brothel creepers, which is a kind of a staple within the kind of what would you say, Tokyo streetwear lexicon, right? That kind of Urahara, Harajuku scene. They love fucking creeper, buffalo creeper type shoes. Look at somebody like Inigo, even through to Babe to Human Made, he's always got a buffalo creeper-esque type of shoe involved in that collection. That feels like it. Look number 18 has divided people on Twitter. They're not liking the fisherman vibes of this, but I don't really mind it, with a double knee. It's kind of like, you know, Pharrell's version of a double knee pant. Same goes for the top with these amazing big leather pockets. Not really too bad about these. We continue here. Some of the bags look amazing. Again on here, that shirling jacket number 20 is really great. I could see fucking Asake or Burna Boy wearing that thing with no top on. This denim suit on the right, look number 24, is definitely up my alley. And something that I would definitely wear is this woolly hat. These hats that Pharrell's created for Louis Vuitton are incredibly good. They're really thick. I'm a big fan of wearing thick hood, woolly hats. I tend to always go for balaclavas because I've got really big hair at top. So in order to have hats that kind of fit my head without looking like a condom, I wear balaclavas. But then the added benefit of wearing balaclavas is that they're usually quite long. So when you roll them up, you get this really thick effect. So if it's cold, you get the ability to have something that kind of makes your head feel warm, and just style-wise, they just suit your head a little bit better. I think personally, even though I've got a big head, they work. So Pharrell did the same sort of thing. It feels like with this woolly or this beanie, it looks thicker than regular ones. It kind of gives it this really interesting shape, so you can make it look like, you know, you can make it, you can style it in different ways, which I kind of love about it. Then you've also got this denim suit, which is essentially got this print, the Damier print, it feels like, with these square dots all over the place, and you essentially got it in the different blue denim fades, which is a really clever way of incorporating the LV flipping pattern in a denim suit. I fucking love it personally. I think that looks great. I love the fit and the cut of the denim jacket. Again, it feels like it's a Nigo influence here, because he's the master of kind of the cut of a perfect denim jacket, because he's got one of the best, you know, personal collections of vintage Levi denim jackets, 101s and whatnot. I forgot whatever shape they are specifically, but he's got loads of them in his collections that he kind of uses as a, you know, as a template to make his own for his own brand. So that looks absolutely incredible. You've got a look here with a kid driving a fucking little golf cart with the trunks at the back as well. It looks great. Look number 22. Look number 25 is absolutely amazing, with a long trench coat and the boots. I love this yellow and brown checkered board print on the bags. I think the bags are going to do absolute bits and numbers. Again, I'm sure it's something that they were told in-house by the team, like, hey, we sell a lot of bags. Bags are our bread and butter. If you smash it with the bags, it doesn't actually matter what you do in terms of clothing on the runway, you're going to kill it. And I think he kind of did that also in that regard. But he kind of did, you know, he killed two birds with one stone. He kind of did what Marc Jacobs used to do at Louis Vuitton, where he'd make incredible bags, but he'd also have incredible clothes. So it kind of, you know, was killed two birds with one stone. I love this look number 27. This rugby top that looks like it's been made out of leather or something looks incredible. Maybe not the most, you know, what you call it? Maybe it hasn't got the best ventilation. You might sweat your balls off of it, but I fucking love how that looks personally. Again, that checkerboard print, I'm all over it. Looks absolutely fantastic. Same goes for look number 29. There's some great little loafers or slippers there. I love the fucking bowling shoes. Look at that. Look number 28. I would look absolutely fantastic in it, especially the fucking colors and stuff. Like, whoever's doing the styling smashed it. The yellow glasses, that yellow, those round yellow frames on this guy's black skin with this tone of this blue purple hue, the bright red back, like, it just all sits amazingly. The colors on this are so good. The yellow, the red, the, you know, the blue, the dark blue, the navy, the black, whatever that kind of hue is, and this green pop on these bowling shoes is great. I love that. Again, with this fucking denim suit, looks absolutely fantastic. It looks like he's got his own version of a chore jacket there on the top. That looks really great. Again, this checkerboard print is definitely one of my favorites. It kind of reminds me a little bit of there's a Vivian Westwood print, actually, if I'm not mistaken. There's a Vivian Westwood Cambridge satchel, and I think it was yellow. I think that's why I like that print. Yeah, there you go. See, there's a yellow. I've got the other version that's white. Back over here. Yeah, I've got the white version, but there's this version here that I actually wanted when I used to work at the store. I couldn't get it. See, there's actually three colorways. I didn't actually remember the brown one. There's actually three colorways of it. It comes in the white, which I have here, and the yellow and the black, and obviously the brown and the black. But I think that print, that yellow print, kind of reminds me a little bit of what Pharrell's doing with that checkerboard print that he's got going on here. That print there, it looks very familiar to this one over here, courtesy of Vivienne Westwood. That print, that's probably why I'm really a fan of it. I love that. Maybe that's inspiration for it, I'm not really too sure, but it looks absolutely fantastic. Let's continue with that. And then also, what I also liked, look number 33 is great. Again, that print, that damier, is it damier print? I'm pretty sure that's what it's called. With the little, edits on them with the dots, and it looks really great there. That massive bag looks absolutely stupendous. I've not seen one bag that I don't like, actually. This hat with the little ear flaps on the head look really cool, because it also looks like something that you said you could tie like a do-rag at the back of your head, which looks great, amazing. Again, nice bags. Another inclination of a kind of a chore jacket with the excessive flares. It looks like they maybe these guys' legs are a bit skinnier than Pharrell's, but because I feel like Pharrell's flares he did before were a little bit too like skinny jeans with the flares at the bottom, bell bottoms. I feel like these are a little bit more of a relaxed fit, so they look a little bit better than what Pharrell was wearing. Oh, look at this guy, this uncle in his suit looks absolutely incredible. I love it. The casting also in this show is absolutely superb. Whoever handled that, look number 37 looks great. I'm a big fan of that. And then you've got Pusha T in look number 39 with an incredible all leather outfit that says Louis Vuitton Lovers Presents. Looks absolutely incredible with the NY logo all over it. And then you've got his brother Malice also there with the same jacket and also in blue. And those snowball jacket things, shoes that he's wearing. They look incredible when they walk down the runway. This white and blue checkerboard again reminds me a little bit of Human Made. I feel like they've got this design before. This beanie is definitely something that I want 100%. ASAP Rocky was wearing it. It's covered in pearls and stuff. So the damier squares are essentially little pearls on top of the flipping beanie. So it looks absolutely incredible. It's a really luxury looking version of a hat. This digital print cut, thing on the coat on look number 42. People are now accusing Pharrell of copying JW Anderson because he's got the same digitized type of design for stuff that he was doing for Luebe, which I don't think is true. They look very different in what they were doing, especially in execution. What JW Anderson was trying to do was essentially take a 2D image and make it 3D. Right, it's like a 2D cutout of a hoodie, but make it look like it's, it's a 3D object, make it look 2D. Whereas this is just a graphic on a jacket that's been made to look a particular way, right? It's not actually, trying to make the cut of this jacket look like a 2D shape sort of thing. So it's a really strange argument online, but hey, people are arguing about it. Again, the Mary Jane shoes with the pop socks, that's going to be a real challenge to wear for most people, but I'm eager to see how people kind of incorporate them here. These boots, these snowboardy boot type things that Pharrell's been rocking all the time are really interesting too. I've said before, I'm really interested to see what he does in terms of footwear collaborations, because we know Pharrell's got a long-standing relationship with Adidas, but obviously Louis Vuitton did a lot of stuff with Nike just before Virgil passed away. Wonder if he got the opportunity, would he want to work with Nike personally through the avenue of Louis Vuitton, or does his contract at Adidas not permit him to do so? Do you know what I mean? Even though he's not working under the guise of him, human raid or human race or whatever, it's under Louis Vuitton. I'm curious to see how that develops over time. Again, here, look number 46 is fantastic. You got Dave walking the runway, which I didn't really notice at first, but Dave is there looking great in look number 47 in a classic kind of New York style, bomber jacket. Oh wow, I didn't realize Stefano Pilati from Random Identities was there. He looks fantastic because he actually wears this. They see, this is the way it looks, wear great on. I think there are some guys you can just get away with wearing skirts or kilts, right? I'd imagine like gay presenting guys like Stefano Pilati, but I think he also just looks good in clothes in general. He just has a effervescent, he just has a fucking swag is on absolutely fucking 10,000 when it comes to what he absolutely wears on a day-to-day basis. But he's definitely one of my fucking style icons when it comes to what he wears street style wise. I wish he would be out and about in town more so you can see more of his outfits, but he's definitely incredible. You should definitely check out his brand called Random Identities. It's definitely one of the most underrated ones out there. Although I think I checked his Instagram recently, he didn't have any links to it in his bio. I wonder if it's like now defunct. I'm not really sure what's going on, but a really talented designer, formerly of YSL, and just really amazing. So he looks really great in his outfit. He's got this kilt on with these great little frilly pop socks that Pharrell did, which kind of remind me a little bit of the Michael Jackson socks from years gone back. Then he's wearing this jacket in this damn earprint that kind of looks like a Chanel tweed jacket. It's sort of like he's kind of looked for it, and these glasses with the pearls all around the rims, which he's done before. I feel like he's done before, but maybe he's kind of updated them in this regard, with Louis Vuitton. Again, a great look here in terms of a denim suit, look number 51, look number 50, or leather, the fur on look number 49. Exquisite. Most likely it's faux fur because you don't want to get any complaints from people, but the color, the tone, the little incline, addition of the logos that look like they've been, I'm not sure if they've been burned in Boston, I'm not sure how they've done that finish, but they look absolutely incredible, especially with the bag and the way he's holding them in a suit underneath. Brilliant. Oh, that fucking Scott, I guess is what's called like a shawl, the same thing that he was wearing in some of the promo pictures when he took the Louis Vuitton job for real. It looked number 52, looks fantastic. I love these glasses here. They kind of remind me of the Dennis Rodman Oakleys that he wore or made famous, that have the kind of, they sort of have the strap that goes around your ears that come across your head. In this particular one, there's only one little pearl section that goes right on top of your head. I said before that I was kind of bored of pearls, but I think I'm going to be back into them again now, seeing what I've seen here. We've got a great red outfit here. I wonder, actually, I didn't see when I was watching the show, but there's actually a suit that Skepta was wearing. It was an M65 with a matching pants that looked absolutely fantastic. I'm wondering if it's included in here too. Let me see. There's a good beret look here. Another nice kilt. This tracksuit is absolutely banging. This is definitely going to be popular with a lot of people also. And again, those massive, really fluffy slippers with the bear print paws at the bottom. I thought this guy here looked like Ruigi, but it's not. Look number 58 looks really great. You've got look number 59. I love the look of this, the leather jacket. The casting is so good. This guy is an OG male model. I'm pretty sure I forgot his name, but this guy, look number 59, is an OG male model. I remember seeing him in some runways before. He looks fucking fantastic. This guy, look number 60, looks absolutely great in this look also with this kilt. This look, it kind of looks relaxed. It looks like they look, this kilt looks like a pair of shorts, actually. That's what it kind of looks like. It kind of looks like a pair of shorts with just a really baggy opening. That's what it sort of looks like to me. But it looks absolutely fantastic. Big up him. He looks absolutely great in it. I love this look as well. Look number 63 with that kind of Chanel-esque looking jacket. That massive color of that red, holder looks absolutely beautiful, as does look number 62. 61 looks great also. Oh, look at these. All these models towards the end. See, this is when the show really hotted up. The models and the casting and the styling towards the end really sold it for me. 64. And 65, I'd be all over, especially 64. That jacket is absolutely banging. Then 66 is another one a lot of fans have been spotting, because this particular varsity jacket, with the PLA, I think, on it, written on the front, is definitely a jacket that Pharrell used to wear back in the day a lot. A famous jacket that he kind of pulled back in, self-reference himself, and put it into a Louis Vuitton show, updated it a little bit here and there, but it's essentially a little bit of a nod to kind of his history with clothes. That's really cool to see that. Again, look at this amazing crocodile inspired jacket. The major ends in this outfit look incredible, actually, to be fair. I'd rock the fuck out of these two looks. Look number 68 and 69 of those Mary Janes. Like, the Mary Janes worn with regular black pants and this leather jacket is incredible, with the little water flask there. And then obviously the Mary Janes worn with this look number 68. He kind of looks like a bellboy, but I do like that vibe. It looks really good there. Another look here with some loafers with, again, I think pearls or some accoutrements on the socks. You got look number 70 here, looks incredible, as does look number 71. The end bit is definitely my favorite towards the end. 72 looks great. That fur jacket is great. This kind of gives me a lot of Tom Ford vibes, to be fair. Tom Ford at Gucci, it's definitely giving me something about that. That big wide shoulders of this fur jacket, the lapels are massive. This little small bag, the relaxed trouser fit, the tight, like everything around it feels very, very much like an old school fucking Tom Ford. You got the models coming out there, and again, you got the fucking track jacket there also. But yeah, this whole entire collection was absolutely banging. And then throughout the end, surprisingly, he didn't cry. I thought he would cry. He didn't. Yeah, there's a look with the track, with the outfit that I was talking to you about that Skepta had on. That was absolutely incredible. This whole entire suit looks so good with the M65 and the trousers. You got Pharrell here with Naomi Campbell. You got Jared Leto there, Tekashi. You got Kelly Rowland. You got Zendaya, Anita, the Brazilian singer, Willow and Jaden Smith. You got Offset. Who else was there? Let's see these other celebrity pictures and shit. And then Kim Kardashian looked an absolute mess. I did Megan Thee Stallion, to be fair. Megan Thee Stallion looked like she was getting styled by EJ the King again, which she didn't. But the worst definitely fit was definitely Kim Kardashian. She's starting to look her age. Father Time doesn't stop for anyone. And the outfit was absolutely deplorable, considering what show she was at in general. Really, really horrible. But regardless, final reviews. For me, I definitely would give it a high 8 out of 10, maybe even a 9, especially when I consider my doubts about his, you know, first debut over there at Louis Vuitton, and the fact that he smashed it, and the fact that it started off a bit shaky from looks number one all the way to maybe look number, I don't know, it started shaky maybe until look number 23, and the rest of it then just went another level from 24 onwards. He really smashed it. Ready to wear is incredible. Accessories looks great. Footwear looks amazing also. And I think it's going to do absolute numbers once it finally gets in store. And it's a great platform for him to kind of go on and tell an interesting story with the collection he has going forward. So I'm really pleased to see this. And I can't wait to see what some of this stuff looks like in person and what's going to sell, what's not going to sell and stuff, and how the conversation progresses. But in terms of other things to look at a bit more critically, if you're a fashion student, I guess it's somewhat a little bit disconcerting to see somebody that comes from music who has no formal training whatsoever and who kind of is known as somebody that kind of, you know, maybe thrives within a collaborative space where they need to create small capsule collections, be given the reins at a luxury house like flipping Louis Vuitton with all their resources to create a full fashion collection. It can bum you out a little bit. But I also think, maybe going forward, considering what's been happening with some of these kind of, with some of these hires that's been happening recently, where these big luxury houses have been trying to tap into young up and coming designers to try and modernize their brand and welcome new, you know, fans to them, whatever it may be. And it kind of ending in absolute tatters with the recent expulsion of Ruigi from Bali or Bali, however you pronounce it, and the other one with Ludovic over there at flipping Andela Musta, and that having those issues over there. I think there's definitely something to needs to be said for maybe these brands deciding, instead of going for young up and coming people who they're not going to nurture and protect, because, you know, they, number one, they don't feel like they do their due diligence anyway. I feel like the Ruigi issue being a good one. Once the story came out about him that he's being sued by one of his investors in a brand, suddenly everybody on social media had stories to tell about Ruigi scamming and being a bit dodgy from day dot. So if that's the case and everybody knew it as an open secret, Bali should have done their research before hiring him personally and never gave him the job in fact. Or if they were going to hire him, know that the baggage he comes with. But deciding after the fact, to then fire somebody because you think they're going to be bad for PR is really gross, because eventually that could really harm the person's career trajectory and you've kind of wasted their time and you've damaged your brand in the process. So a lot of these brands aren't doing the due diligence necessary. They're very risk adverse. They don't want any bad blowback. Maybe it's because of what happened with John Galliano and stuff, I'm not really too sure. But the era of the rock star kind of, you know, disruptor, bad boy, bad girl designer is completely gone. They want safe options. If that's the case, maybe hiring people like Pharrell and doing that for future appointments is the way to go. If you can't hire somebody that's super experienced, if you can't get Marc Jacobs to come and take over that kind of ilk of a designer, and you have to go for somebody maybe that's available, whatever, maybe less experienced, maybe going with somebody that is an influencer in that space or somebody that can work well in a collaborative team might be the best way to go about it, because you get the ability to have somebody with star power in that role. You have the ability to have their contact book open to you, because, you know, I don't think Louis Vuitton are able to book a Jay-Z, have all those people fly in, attend the show if they don't have a Virgil, if they don't have a Pharrell. Those people are going to be the ones that are going to bring the people and the culture to your show. So that definitely works. So that obviously is a good thing. And then you also have the ability to keep intact your creative design team who you trust, because they've been the bedrock of the brand for many, many years, to basically work with this main person to bring their dreams true, because, or to fruition, because they don't have any experience of kind of doing it themselves. So you kind of, you know, are able to kind of keep the same team without having to expend on new salaries and new people every time you hire in a new creative director who's got different ideas than the last one. So that might be a good way to go about doing things. It's a sort of like a fail-safe version. Then what you do is that you tell the youngsters coming up, graduating from uni, hey, instead of trying to come here to be a creative director, why don't you come here and try and work behind the scenes, being a seamstress, being a pattern cutter, working in fabrication, working in materials, working in ideation, whatever it may be called, right? Just behind the scenes stuff and work your way up that way. And then once you get the experience necessary and you feel the urge, you can go out and launch your own brand. But coming here with the proviso of just being a creative director might be the best wrong way to go about things. Or you could even end up doing like an Alessandro Michele, where you work at a brand for a very long time, and then once the opening comes available, they might recommend you for the top spot if that opening is there. But maybe this is the way to go forward. Maybe more of these houses should be hiring, you know, influential people in culture to take those roles, especially with the star power, because they know they are safe options, especially the ones that are a little bit more experienced in the industry, long in the tooth, like a Pharrell, have been there, done that, who can work well with corporations, work well with others, can play the game very well as Pharrell can. You know, he's kind of like the opposite of Kanye in that regard. He knows how to kind of play the game well and appear polite, appear humble, while also being a complete savage behind the scenes and also having the ability to execute at a really high level. That probably is the way to go about things. But like I said, I could also understand if you're at St. Martin's, if you're at Westminster, if you have all these fashion colleges, Parsons, whatever it may be called, and you're seeing Pharrell out there trot out that collection, it can maybe, you know, be a bit demoralizing, because you know more than likely it means that the possibility of you ending up there at the top helm isn't really within your grasp. But the benefit of it is that it does expose the industry to people and show that, hey, most of these big brands, you know, they don't really need you to know how to pattern cut in order to have that job. They have people in the studio, in those places that know how to do that stuff. All they need you to do is to kind of steer the ship and kind of give an overall direction, and then things can go from that way. So that's definitely where that kind of comes from. So it was great to kind of see that from Pro in that regard. But regardless, really impressed with the collection. Loved it all. The only thing I hated, actually, to be honest, was the choir. I think I'm over the fucking black choir thing, the spirituality of it, all that nonsense. Luckily, it wasn't the Sunday service choir, because that choir is fucking garbage. I don't care what anyone says. Hearing those little kids screeching and wailing is annoying. Hearing regular people try and turn fucking gospel songs into house anthems is awful. I hate it. So at least they weren't that bad, but still, I'm kind of over it. But the beats, regardless of it, once that beat kicked in from Pharrell, that four bar count, that layered drum pattern, oof, that was absolutely hard. I was bopping my head all along with it. But the gospel stuff, enough of that, please. Enough of that theatrics. But overall, loved it, loved it, loved it.